I felt like Steve Kerr, for the first time, didn't know what lineup to go with. You play 11 guys.
Well, this is...
In the finals, you don't play 11 guys, Nick. You buckle down your rotation. You play maybe 8.
Tighten it up.
But he does. Well, this is how... What's the one series they've lost? The Cavs. And what was... I know people talk about the block and the shot, but the turning point of that game was in the fourth quarter when, on back-to-back possessions, Festus Ezeli... In the fourth quarter of Game 7 of the Finals, is guarding LeBron James. And he hits he gets him to foul him on a three, and then he hits a three on him. Kerr, when he doesn't have Durant, has always had these super expansive rotations, and it's hard to have a set rotation when you're playing 11 guys.
Why is it more important in the finals compared to, we get away with it in the regular season, we've seen the first three rounds, but in the finals, what does it mean to the players and the effect that it has on the game?
If you don't have a bench that can score the basketball, you can't afford to go long periods without Steph and Klay being on the floor. So that's where hurts Golden State, not having that third legit score. You got to remember, Draymond Green and Andre Iguodala are guys that they are capable of scoring, but they're not great offensive players. So they don't have a third guy right now. DeMarcus Cousins coming off a huge injury. Saw it last night. You're probably going to get what you got from him last night. He may be a little bit more effective, but
right. He's
not going to be able to give you much. He missed 14 games. To expect more than 8 to 10 minutes from him would probably be...
Right. He's very limited. He can't go into the low post, do you think, and have the quickness and skill that you typically would
see. And they beat him a couple times in the pick and roll last night. He gave up a couple layups, and you don't know how many opportunities that you can really take and help giving up layups. So I think this is the first time Golden State is going to have to make a second and third adjustment. I think the rotation has to get tighter. If it's going to be Jordan Bell, I think he tried to go up to Hampton 5 a little bit to start the game to see if they can get Marc Gasol out the game. And Jordan Bell's skill set is not as good as obviously a Kevin Looney. That, you know, and Kevin Looney played well last night, but he's not the same type of skill set. So they're missing that third score, so they're going to have to tighten some things up.
Well, they're going to have to...
tougher series than what the Warriors thought it was going to be.
Well, and listen, I understand you want to stick to your expected minutes for Steph and Klay. But once you see you're down 10 at halftime and you don't hit them with that flurry in the third quarter, then guess what? Steph might need to play the entire fourth quarter. Like, say, Kawhi played 43 minutes. We have seen Steph played right at the high end of what we ever see him play, 40 minutes. Now, game 6 against Houston, he played that whole second half because he had to. I understand it's game 1. You don't want it. But they're not playing every other day like they did in the conference finals. You just had 9 days off. You don't play again until Sunday. Steph needs to be, until KD comes back, I think you can rest Steph for a few minutes at the beginning of the second quarter. You can hope you're in position to rest him at the beginning of the fourth. But you got to be ready to not play him only 7.5 minutes in the fourth quarter, to play him the entire fourth quarter and to go there, because you're totally right that with Boogie limited, with Iggy hadn't hit a shot since the second, or three since the second round, you need Steph out there not only for his offense, but the way he opens things up for your more limited offensive
players. Maybe you got to get more out of Klay Thompson. Maybe in the finals you got to get more than 21 points out of Klay Thompson.
Well, Klay Thompson is a great three-point shooter. He comes off screens. He's not a guy that you can get a basketball to. He's going to create off the dribble. He's limited in that. So you got to understand his strengths and weaknesses. He benefits, obviously, great from playing with Steph and obviously Kevin. Mm-hmm. But he's a guy that's not going to go put it on the deck and get his own. You're going to have to set screens for him and have to move. And Toronto's too good defensively to just let him come off and just shoot threes. And he tried to get going last night. He took a couple bad shots early in the game to try to get himself going. And when those shots don't go in, he becomes very limited, because he's not, unless he gets it in transition, he's not a guy that's going to kill you in the half court because he doesn't deck it really well.
Yeah, no other star player gets the type of treatment that Klay. Klay can disappear, have bad games. People don't say too much about him. But I think as we go on with this series, one of the things that we underestimated was the all-NBA type level defenders that Toronto have. So you can talk about KD not being there. You can talk about Klay not getting his shot. You can talk about Van Fleet when he was on Steph, how he struggled. But man, this is a great defensive team. This is the best defensive team that they have faced in the championship in their 5-year run. Go up and down the roster.
I think it's the best defense they've played in any round. This is their 20th series they've played over these 5 years. To me, this is the best defense. That Memphis team in 2015 could contend, and Spurs,
they gave them some problems.
They went up 2-1, and the Spurs in 2017 would have been the best defense, but Kawhi got hurt two and a half quarters in. Mm-hmm. But you have Kawhi Leonard, who's won 2 Defensive Player of the Year awards. Marc Gasol has won a Defensive Player of the Year award. Danny Green, who's been on the all-defensive team. Pascal Siakam, who I think will be on an all-defensive team. Serge Ibaka, who's been on all-defensive teams. And Kyle Lowry, who got snubbed from an all-defensive team. And then Van Vliet,
yes,
who's playing his tail off right now. Like, you've got, there's the 7 guys you're playing. Those are the 7 guys that played more than 5 minutes last night. All of them are playing like the upper echelon defensive players, which is why you've got to be the team that gets out and run, not Toronto.
And there is no other combination like it in the NBA where you can name off 7 players deep. And what do they do? 3 and D. They shoot the 3, all of them, and all of them play elite level defense. This is going to be a great series.
Well, we said this yesterday. We said you have one team with this top ranked offense and another team with the second ranked defense. And when you put those two together, who's going to come out on top? And it looked like Toronto's defense last night did.
And Jenna, your point on Klay Thompson, though, can't be missed. That when KD's not out there, Klay was upset, remember? As you pointed out, see, he didn't make an all-NBA team. Okay. Like, this is where, and we know Klay can do it, by the way. The moment will never be too big for Klay Thompson. He has some of the greatest playoff moments, including one of the greatest playoff games anyone's ever had, Game 6 against Durant and the Thunder in 2016. But they needed more from him last night. You mentioned he had 21, but so I think at least 5 of those points came, I don't want to call it garbage time, because it was never quite garbage time last night, but when they were at like 2% to win the game.
But think about it, you look at Steph. He goes to the line 14 times. Klay Thompson does not post up. He's not a guy that decks it well. So his game is predicated on getting out in transition, getting open threes, maybe getting the layup, or he's going to have to get screen set for him. They're too good a defensive team. They can switch. He's not going to get those wide open looks. So I don't know what we can expect from Klay Thompson. We know he's very capable of having a huge night. But if he's only going to get 12, 13, maybe 14 shot attempts, that's not going to happen because he does not get to the free throw line at all. He's not the type of guy that attacks the basket like that off the dribble.
Got to the free throw line once.
Yeah, see, he's got some limitations to his game. And that plays right into Toronto's hands.
All right, Antoine, take a break. See you a little bit later on in the show.